Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I just want me to remind people to please turn off their phones before we begin, so they don't start ringing. And before I introduce our speaker this afternoon, I'd like to make a couple of announcements. In this series, the Interdisciplinary Lecture Series at the Center for Translation Studies, we have one more lecture this semester that is coming up on Monday, May 9th. And it will be delivered by Ahmed Lakhdar, who is a theater director, playwright, and translator, who's also my student and a UC, very troublemaker. Who's the troublemaker? But brilliant director. And his talk is entitled Beyond the Text, Theatrical Translation in the Age of Globalization. We also have a parallel series in Tahrir, and there also we have one lecture remaining. This will take place on Tuesday, April 9th, and will be delivered by Mohammed Taufi, who is a novelist and former and diplomat. He was our former ambassador to the United States, which is retired actually. This year. And not only is he a novelist, he's also a translator. He translates his own works, and some of you may recall that all of AUC read one of his texts, I think, last year, Candy Girl, in this One Community, One Book program that we have. And he was here to speak about that text. This time around, he will be speaking about self-translation, faithful rendition or rewriting. So try and join us if you can for these two final events in both series. Now I turn to our speaker this afternoon. I'm very, very pleased that Professor Ellen Kenney has accepted our invitation to speak at the Center for Translation Studies. Busy as she is, she has several conferences and several other important projects to be working on. Ellen joined the American University in Cairo in fall of 2011. Interesting date to arrive in Cairo. After a three-year project in the Islamic Art Department at the Metropolitan Museum, where she did curatorial research for their new galleries. Prior to that, she taught courses in Islamic Art at NYU, Fordham University, and FIT. And she participated in archaeological projects in Jordan. Her research centers on the art and architecture of the medieval Eastern Mediterranean. Professor Kenney's talk this afternoon is intriguingly entitled Islamic Art and its Intradisciplinary Translations. So without further ado, please help me welcome the professor.
Visual culture of the Arabian Peninsula has been represented, again in the early literature. And to address the third theme, we'll look at a specific monument. So having sort of sketched that out for you, some introductory remarks. Last month I presented two papers at the annual conference of the College Art Association, or the CAA. And this is the main professional organization for scholars in history and criticism in the arts. The CAA is to the field of art history sort of what MESA is for Middle East Studies, or the MLA for literature. So it's a big, broad professional conference. And both of my conference papers dealt with aspects of Islamic art. They both addressed, sort of either indirectly or directly, questions about the field's historiography. But both were on panels that were, the themes of the panels were not exclusively connected with Islamic art. So they were more general art history. And preparing for these presentations, I found myself really combing through what's become a rather substantial body of literature that's reflecting on the state of the field of Islamic art. These works include journal articles, keynote papers, and review essays, as well as prefaces and sort of introductory chapters to the Islamic art surveys and to the collected or edited volumes that we have. And collectively, they outline the field's foundations, its definitions, its development, and its prospects. And they assess its place in the academy, in the museum, and to a certain extent in local and global communities. And they address the challenges of researching and teaching Islamic art. Two of the themes that recur throughout this body of self-reflective state of the field literature are the positioning of the Islamic art specialization within the discipline of art history, and the different ways that the arts of the Islamic world have come to be translated into the discursive language of this broader discipline. I found that the process of preparing and presenting papers for these intra-disciplinary panels at the CAA conference is a kind of performance of that translation, of this interdisciplinary translation. So in today's talk, what I'm interested in examining are some of the ways that this interdisciplinary translation has played out in the early scholarship in the field, and how that's shaped the introductory literature. And I'd like to at least keep in the background ideas about the role that this introductory literature has played in shaping the current interdisciplinary conversations that are going on now. First, though, I think it will be useful to touch on some points about the specialization's development. As an area of study today, the history of Islamic art constitutes a field of specialization within the discipline of art history. The broader discipline, rooted in the traditions of Vitruvius, Vasari, and Winckelmann, established by the middle of the 19th century, and from the outset, it's dedicated primarily to understanding the artistic traditions of the West. As a result, it's widely acknowledged throughout the state of the field literature I surveyed that the specialization of Islamic art developed out of a cultural orbit separate from that of its subject, and the discipline of art history conceived of the subject of Islamic art as separate from its own cultural sphere and its own trajectory. This, by the way, is not just an anonymous classroom. It's the renowned modern art historian Linda Nachman, in 1959, teaching a class at Vassar College. So one of the favorite illustrations of this relationship is published as the frontispiece of Sir Banister Fletcher's Survey of Architectural History. And here we find Islamic art, or as Fletcher names it, Saracenic art, is positioned kind of on this dead-end offshoot off of the Greco-Roman trunk of the tree of architecture. Farther into Sir Bannister Fletcher's survey of architecture, we find, we can look at the table of contents, where we see that Islamic art is situated in an entirely separate section devoted to what he designates as the non-historical styles. And his introductory remarks, which I've excerpted here, to this separate section, kind of provide his justification of this segregation in terms that explicitly privilege the goal of pursuing the Western canon. So today, Islamic art is still routinely kind of set apart in this way in the 20th and 21st century art historical classification system that we would encounter in the general survey textbooks about Islamic art, about art history, I mean. And it's also set up this way very often in the curricular structure in art history programs within the academy. But now it appears under the heading non-Western art rather than non-historical. But then non-Western art is sort of serving as this catch-all phrase, which is, you know, kind of can encompass the visual arts of Africa, Oceania, South America, and all of Asia. So essentially everything except Europe and North America, right? So returning to our state of the field literature, just about every one of those essays that I was referring to above notes that Islamic art history is a latecomer on the scene. That is, it arrived as an academic field of specialization nearly a century later than the establishment of the broader discipline of art history itself. And just as it would be impossible to alter one's birth order, there appears to be no way for Islamic art scholarship to catch up with its older siblings, at least judging from this state of the field literature, in which the immaturity of the specialization and the ideas of its belatedness continue to be cited. In fact, the assessment of the field's relative youth seems to have an inverse relationship with the passage of time. So that in 1910, Ernst Hertzfeld, who could be considered one of the specialization's first practitioners, acknowledged in an essay where he was exploring the genesis of Islamic art, simply that the study of Islamic art history and archaeology is indeed very young. Straightforward. Over 70 years later, in 1983, Oleg Grabar, perhaps Islamic art's most famous and prolific second-generation scholar, you could say, would describe the field as being, quote, in its infancy. And this characterization would be echoed another decade hence by Robert Irwin. By 2003, it would seem that the situation had regressed, with Grabar bemoaning, quote, the backwardness of the field in particular in practically all its developments, from high intellectual speculation to the cataloging of basic information. And with Robert Hillenbrand pronouncing that Islamic art historians were, quote, stuck, if not in the Jurassic, then still in an early stage of the evolution of their subject. Still another decade on, a review would characterize the specialization as a veritable newcomer to the canon. There appears to be a kind of Dorian Gray phenomenon at play here. To sum up then, from the perspective of the broader home discipline of art history, Islamic art is both other and late. Those are themes that I wanted to sort of stick with. So those doing Islamic art history have often been engaged in a process of translating monuments from a newly encountered visual culture into a long-established language of art historical discourse on the Western canon. And this process involves appropriating disciplinary methods and theories developed for studying Western art and applying them to objects and building arts and urban formations generated in the sphere of the Islamic world. Even the naming of the disciplinary specialization entailed a kind of intradisciplinary translation, ought to be classified regionally, as had been done, for example, in the case of Aegean art, or would it make more sense to classify it based on national or ethnic constructs, as with, say, Etruscan art? Or was there a stylistic term that could do the job along the lines of Baroque? As we saw with the passage quoted earlier from Hertzfeld's 1910 essay, he was an early adopter of Islamic as a descriptor. In 1933, when the first American university position in the specialization was established, this was actually the University of Michigan, this naming process was still in transition. The title of that post was the Freer Fellow and Lecturer in Oriental Art. That's not even one of the ones I put in the world. It wasn't until the mid-20th century that the term Islamic had gained almost universal favor. However, this nomenclature introduced its own dilemmas. The project of defining the specialization proved thornier than naming it. Even in introductory level literature, it usually results in a run-on sentence, if not a paragraph or more, of text. And the very notion that the visual culture of the Islamic world can rationally be considered a single art historical specialization has had to be elaborately defended from its inception, with justifications ranging from the dispassionate and practical to the esoteric and highly essentializing. So back to our roadmap, we'll move on to this area of, or this theme of major and minor art. These explanations really aim to tackle only one part of the term Islamic art. To paraphrase Kipling's conundrum, so it's Islamic, but is it art? Once ensconced under the disciplinary tent of art history, the field's early generations of practitioners had to contend with art history's hierarchical scaffolding. That's to say, some arts are finer than others. Until very recently, the fine and major arts, that is, architecture, sculpture, painting, and especially canvas painting, had been deemed nobler than the so-called minor arts, such as ceramics, metalwork, and textiles, which were sometimes referred to with similarly value-laden terms, like decorative arts. Even within the category major arts, the Academy accorded history and allegorical subjects a loftier ranking than portraiture, which was higher than landscape painting, which was higher than still life painting, so forth. And these hierarchies of genre left an impression on 20th and 21st century art historical discourse. Historians of Islamic art, especially in the first and second generations, seem to have felt compelled to make their case that their subject could and should be analyzed as a major art. For an example of this major-minor tension playing out in Islamic art's early field crafting, we could look at the way book arts were presented to the uninitiated. Along that spectrum offered by Western art histories, hierarchies of genre, the medium of book illustration and illumination fell somewhere between major and minor. But one of the earliest monographs dedicated to the study of Islamic book arts, published in 1912 by F.R. Martin, launches a direct campaign to position the miniaturist's work on a par with the best of Italian and Northern Renaissance canvas and fresco paintings by such masters as Guazzoli, Bellini, and Durer. Martin, confidently wielding the methodological tools of formal connoisseurship and comparative analysis, established a hierarchy for Persian manuscript illustrations, the best of which he appraised as, quote, masterpieces of the museums of Europe will perhaps very soon placed beside those of the best 15th century masters of Italy and the Netherlands. I couldn't find a slide that showed exact juxtaposition. But I did think, and since we're not really focusing on museum perception anyway, we're more thinking about the academic field and the discipline. So I'm using this instead. It's one of the kind of Gardner's Art Through the Ages. It's one of the standard art history, Art History 101 survey books that you encounter in any kind of survey course. And here we have, in the middle of the text, among the few pages dedicated to the world of Islamic art and architecture, Martin's image, kind of. Martin's insistence on positioning Persian paintings as a major art could be seen as a prescient challenge to art history's canonical hierarchies, and his comparative methodology could be read as a rejection of Islamic art's othering. However, I say could be here because it would be anachronistic to characterize him as so theoretically farsighted, given the general tenor of his writing in this text and elsewhere, which really wasn't that progressive. But it's kind of an intellectual exercise for us. Key to Martin's approach was his focus on the image, the painted illustration, and the relative disregard for the text, the illustrated, and the codex forms of painting. We find a similar approach in a monograph published nearly 70 years later by Richard Ettinghausen, one of Islamic art's most prominent second generation scholars. And throughout his wide-ranging scholarship, Ettinghausen consistently sought to demonstrate the methodological models developed for studying the canon of Western medieval art. So he's kind of focusing more, at least on a kind of chronological comparanda, could be fruitfully employed in analyzing art of the Islamic world. And in his text, Arab Painting, a very influential book which saw multiple editions and was translated into several languages, Ettinghausen said this a comparison and iconographic interpretations are considerably more nuanced than Martin's. But like Martin, his discussion and his reproductions isolate the image from the page as if to treat book illustration as canvas painting to make the minor major. And our colleague Bernard King has recently demonstrated the drawbacks of this kind of truncation of the manuscript page in his study about text and image. So we'll hop to our second theme, and this will take us to a completely different kind of world. Martin's and Ettinghausen's studies of manuscript painting are both examples of general audience introductions to a single artistic medium. The seven decades that span their publication dates witnessed a deluge of writings on Islamic art, ranging from highly specialized studies and comprehensive collection catalogs to general introductory handbooks, whose shared narratives and common monuments contributed to the emergence of a fairly fixed canon. It could be argued, however, that it was not until 1987 that Islamic art produced one of the necessities of a fully arrived academic specialization, and that is a scholarly survey book, the second part of which only appeared in 1994. But anyway, towards the beginning of nearly every one of these survey books or handbooks, the rapid rise of Islam and the sudden apparition of its arts will be trumpeted. This suddenness of Islamic art was predicated on a belief in the absence of artistic tradition in pre-Islamic Arabia. Some critics have linked the appeal of this image of suddenness to the author's absorption of traditional ideas about the Jahiliyyah versus Islam. But an Arabia devoid of visual culture is also essential to Islamic art's formation narrative, according to which the confrontation of the cultural heritage of the Sasanians in Iran and the Byzantine Empire in the Eastern Mediterranean supplied inspiration to fill the supposed void of early Muslim visual impoverishment. This narrative depends mainly on the methodological apparatus of formal art history,
a method that starts with an object, minutely described, classified with like objects, distinguished from dissimilar objects, and then analyzed in terms of its authorship, who was the artist, its provenance, where was it made, and its style. Style is imagined to be something pure, authentic, original, and endogenous, which can influence and be influenced by other styles. A familiar place to see this methodology very clearly at work is in the research of K.A.C. Creswell. Although not trained as an art historian, Creswell adopted the methods of formal art history very determinedly, approaching his research as a quest for the origins of Islamic art and the evolution of its forms. As we see from these excerpts, these origins, in his estimation, were not to be connected with the Arabian location of Islam's revelation. Although Creswell's architectural vacuum has been capably challenged, both directly and indirectly, it's had tremendous staying power in subsequent literature. For example, the authoritative Pelican Survey of Islamic Art, published in 1987, which I referred to above, echoed and reinforced Creswell's vacuum image. And you can see that found here. The assumption here that the absence of evidence means absence is asserted even more categorically a little later on in the same text, where the authors say, and I quote, "Any modification of this impression of poverty in the artistic development of pre-Islamic Arabia produced by excavations, explorations, and a more systematic study of literary documents is hardly likely to be very significant." End of story. The Kaaba, which, when subjected to the methods of formal analysis, emerges to the authors as architecturally unimpressive. The tradition that it was built by a Christian cop from Egypt is produced to demonstrate the poverty of Arabian architectural tradition. The living and inanimate subjects with which the pre-Islamic Kaaba reportedly painted are discounted as, quote, "an innovation of the early 7th century under foreign influences." Thus, the pre-Islamic Kaaba and its decoration are doubly disqualified as a form of cultural evidence. They're not indigenous enough, and they're not early enough. The authors grudgingly admit that, and this is the second edition of the book, which came later, by the way, that the archaeological finds from the Arabian site of the Fao included a fairly rich, quote, fairly rich array of objects brought in from the Mediterranean area, some possibly of Indian origin, and several enigmatic fragments of paintings. However, the authenticity problem emerges here again, because these artifacts were, quote, "not of local manufacture." So insistent on an absence of Arabian visual tradition are these authors, one has to ask, why is it that they protest so much? As we've already seen, when the specialization of Islamic art was first emerging, solidifying its canon and codifying its narrative, the primary mission of early practitioners was to overcome the existing segregation of the new specialization from its disciplinary foundations. To achieve this integration, using formalist methodological tools then at hand, Islamic art's beginnings had to be relocated into a context where its material remains were extant and where they could be better written into an art historical continuum with the Western canon through a kind of translation, or perhaps more properly, a translatio, is when holy relics are moved from one site to another. Now we'll slip into the next theme, which we'll illustrate with the way a particular site has been handled in some of these early texts. A good place to see this kind of translatio and its interdisciplinary translation is in one of Richard Ettinghausen's most famous studies, an essay on the Umayyad period palace known as Cairo. And methodologically, Ettinghausen is probably best known for his use of iconographic analysis. His seminal essay on Hirbatul Mahjar is frequently cited as a set piece of iconographic interpretation. In it, Eddinghausen focuses on one part of the architectural complex. In the monument's diverse architectonic and decorative features, he identifies parallels, both visual and conceptual, with the antecedent arts of the Byzantine and Sasanian empires, and he interprets these features in light of their visual sources and their symbolic or connotative potentials. But Eddinghausen's essay, published in 1972, also functioned as a rebuttal to arguments about the palatial complex and about Islamic art in general that were predicated on residual biases in Western art scholarship. Most earlier interpretations read the kind of eclecticism exhibited in the site's architecture and decoration as evidence of cultural poverty, a lack of aesthetic discernment, and signs of frivolity and eccentricity. Robert Hamilton, for example, who published a monograph on Hirbatul Mahjar in 1959, had expressed the disapproval of ornamentality still prevailing in the early 20th century criticism with his characterization of the site's architectural decoration as, quote, a desert of meaningless ornament. Hamilton's perspective would likely have struck at least some historians of Western art at the time as retrograde, even at the time of its publication. Over a decade earlier, the renowned art theorist Meyer Shapiro was already skewering this conservative view of eclecticism in his writings on Romanesque architecture, where he quipped, "Nothing in our culture has seemed to its critics so evident a sign of decadence as the taste of artists for works of different times and places." So with his 1972 Hirbatul Mahjar essay, Eddinghausen was at the avant-garde of Islamic art, but not of art theory. He asserted the efficacy of a time-honored art historical method of iconographic analysis in decoding Umayyad eclecticism, although we may not agree with all of his interpretations of the site today. What would have been kind of edgy at the time is that he also argued for a sophisticated intentionality and syntactic coherence to the architecture and decoration at Hirbatul Mahjar, describing its program as, quote, purposeful and significant, and, quote, deliberate and meaningful. Above all, though, he saw Hirbatul Mahjar as an integration of Byzantine and Iranian elements, and identified this integration as the genius behind Umayyad art, asserting that much of the subsequent art in Muslim land is due to the catalytic effect of this combination. So while Eddinghausen's iconographic analysis moved the interpretation of Umayyad architecture out of Hamilton's desert of meaninglessness, it was still predicated on the kind of tabula rasa theory that Creswell had advocated. So, we're moving on to some concluding. With these three vignettes from Islamic art literature, I've drawn mostly on studies aimed at introducing Islamic art to an audience informed in the practice of art history, studies engaged in what I consider an exercise of interdisciplinary translation. And I focused on the early phase of the field's historiographic development. If one were to pursue this historiography up to the present and closely trace its course by considering more specialized writing, there would emerge multiple strands representing different theoretical and methodological approaches. One strand would include those scholars who continue to cleave closely to the formalist, connoisseurship-oriented constructs reflected in much of the early scholarship. Another strand would include those who might be considered late adopters of more recent approaches that perhaps are already seen as passé in the corridors of certain fashion-forward art history departments. Still others might be quite in step with the theoretical vanguard. Nevertheless, in 2003, the influential husband and wife team of Islamic art historians, Jonathan Bloom and Sheila Blair, published what would become a rather controversial state of the field piece for the Art Bulletin. The Art Bulletin is one of the publications put out by the College Art Association, so this is one of the journals of a record for the field at large, in which they argued that over the previous several decades, the field seemed to have become more rather than less isolated. By 2010, there had emerged among a group of Islamic art specialists, quote, an urgent sense that Islamic art is at a crossroads. And this resulted in a 3-day workshop devoted to the state of the field held in Berlin. I mean, I think it's quite impressive that 3 full days are devoted to a sort of state of the field workshop. But that was 5 long and eventful years ago. Fast forward to 2016, and judging from this announcement on the right of an upcoming symposium in Madrid, the specialization has gone from crossroads to crisis. And while many of the factors contributing to this crisis, as cited in the symposium description, might seem particular to the field of Islamic art, I find it interesting that a similar sense of peril imbued the broader art history scene at the College Art Association this winter. The impression that the academic discipline sees itself in an existential crisis of relevance was reflected both in a number of the individual panel topics and in the keynote session. One of the papers I presented was on a panel titled Teaching Western and Non-Western Art History, Starting a Global Conversation, a pedagogy panel sponsored by the association's education committee. Judging from the size of the room reserved for the panel, the conference had not anticipated a large audience. However, judging from the full house we had there and the anxious, intense Q&A that followed our presentation, it would seem that interdisciplinary translation between the specialization of Islamic art and the broader discipline of art history may also be at a crossroads of sorts.
Thank you very much. Ladies on the show, any questions?
I have a few minutes left. Go ahead.
Thank you. That was very it gets us lots of things to mull over intellectually. Just one quick question. You sort of been hearing you criticize Ellinghausen for his reliance solely on Byzantine and Persian influence, and if you're looking at each other, what sort of Arabian things do you think you should be talking about with regard to that?
I guess I don't mean to criticize him for or his integration of Sasanian and Byzantine element in the Pyramidal Mock Term, so much as to demonstrate that it's this is an example of part of an explanation for Mayan art. And its suddenness, but I wouldn't take issue with the idea that those are the two major strands in creating the art of the Mayan period or the art of Pyramidal Mock Term in particular. I think what I was hoping to address somehow is kind of way that we approach the possibility of a more kind of dialogic visual culture, and the possibility that this kind of maybe mixing of Eastern and Western visual tradition may be something that was already taking place in the Arabian Peninsula. In ways that aren't so well documented. And so with that slide, especially the first slide of the excavations at Al-Faw, I also don't, by the way, I don't take issue or disagree with the provenance of the objects that are found, the assigned provenance of the objects that are found at Al-Faw, and the idea that they are coming from faraway places, possibly in other visual traditions. But what I think I would sort of call in question is how do we interpret that evidence? Do we say, well, that doesn't matter, it wasn't visual tradition because it didn't come from this place? Or do we say, or is there another way to look at it? And think of some kind of integration and receptiveness to to the visual cultures of other places and integration of those of that material culture that was happening before we started tracing from the point.
Thank you. Many people that work from scholars like you who are very familiar with pre-Islamic Arabia and during Islam as well to
only beginning to be.
It seems to me that what comes across in your talk is a couple of words. One is we have been specialists in Islamic art and art historians. And at that level, two specialists of and in Islamic art, are they trying to redefine their relationship to art history and how can we define the field itself and in its relationship to art history. And then there seems to be the other problem of lumping everything together as Islamic art. And is that being contested by people inside the field?
Yeah, so one of the things that In the slide before the last, where, you know, when I put up the call for papers, that was amazing. One of the especially one of the topics that they kind of tick off when they want to contemplate the different sources of crisis in the field of Islamic art. Among these are this idea that questioning whether can't have this all under an umbrella. So I think, you know, that's the fact that this umbrella has been questioned and so openly has kind of it's one thing that's thrown, I think, the specialization into something of a disease, right? And so there have been a number of ways that that's been brought up. For example, there was, I'm not sure, I think maybe in 2008, there was a conference of Islamic art historians. So this is, we have every other year, we have a big conference of our own nowadays. And there, at one of these big conferences, there was a keynote talk in which it was suggested that the field should not, there should still be an umbrella, but it should really, in the academy, that it needs to be divided up into, I think the proposal in that case was into chronological, kind of early, middle, late periodization, so that it was something that could be more, that could be pursued with the kind of depth everybody in the field is pushing. But it's interesting because I think that that just the notion that you know of re-questioning whether this is a term that works now really is kind of cited as one of the components of this crisis, right? And of course other things that put it in crisis have to do with destruction of cultural heritage, and things that have to do with, this troubling word Islamic for a lot of the world right now. When I was first a graduate student, and for many years after, when among art historians, when you wanted to say what you did as a specialization, we were Islamicists. That was our name. It's like, what are you? What do you say? I'm a medievalist. I do Northern Wren. You know, you add all these little kind of ways of labeling yourself. So our label for ourselves was Islamist. So, you know, just talk about crisis. I mean, you're sitting there watching the news and suddenly you see this thing that I've called myself for all these years and somehow, So you notice through this whole talk, I never referred to us as Islamicists, which is how we would have it 10 years ago. There are all these different kind of things that we consider sources of kind of Christ in the field, right? I'm still kind of putting this together because the conference experience is kind of fresh, but there was at the end of the Q&A and the conversations that were held afterward, I think that the field of art history sees perhaps their some kind of salvation in the idea of global art history. So, for decades, if you studied art history at university, the first course you had to take was the art history survey, cave painting to Mondrian, right? And sometimes that would be spread out over a whole year, sometimes that would be done in one whole semester, depending on how intense things were. And we used to call that the survey of art history. And now with kind of this, eventually this global studies kind of focus, I think I'm on the record, but it's just like off the record. But I think there were a lot of art history programs that just renamed the course, right? Because it seems kind of global, to take this, but you are kind of going all around the world, and so I think there are a lot of programs where this traditional art survey just got renamed global art history, and you can see that with Gardner's with the textbook names too, right? But how much has conceptualization of art history been actually transformed from being one that is very closely connected with Sir Bannister Fletcher's tree of architecture, right, into something that we could consider a global studies course? I'm really not so sure about that, right? But I think globalization, global studies was seen as kind of the salvation for the crisis of relevance that art history is experiencing. They're still stinging from some remarks that President Barack Obama made a couple of years ago about saying that people could do a lot better getting a vocational degree than a degree in art history. There were angry letters written, and there were apologies made, by the way. I think we see that kind of crisis for humanities studies everywhere, maybe including also, so put it into that conversation.
Thank you very much. It's really interesting, actually, because you sort of pointed to three different things that are very much tied into what I do. Because, I mean, your version of global art history we call world literature, and your version of, let's say, this, the reevaluation of the history of pre-Islamic or early Islamic architecture is obviously something that's happening as well in the late antique. We call it late antique, you guys call it whatever Islamic continuity. In some ways, one is very sympathetic with people like Eddinghausen, because the state of Islamic archaeology, really only in the past 10 years can we say we have something approaching, you know, proper Islamic archaeology areas. But the other thing that I try and do in my work is to study the development of the tradition. I don't know if you know that, I mean, Shahab Ahmed's book, you know, he said that he wrote that book because he went to the Met and saw the galleries and was offended that the word Islamic had been removed from the title of the gallery. Something now they're called Asia Africa, West Asia Africa, something like this. You know, it's no longer an Islamic collection. And that's what's, and I haven't finished the book, so I can't tell you where that's going, but one thing I feel responsible for is studying the development of a tradition. So in one sense, could you say that you represent something like Islamic art history because there is this kind of, you know, in the Islamic world, right, broadly defined, there is this process by which they're constantly influencing each other and building on echoes and stuff like this. I mean, there is still one way in which we can say that there is something that's Islamic about Islamic art.
So I'm not someone who's on the vanguard of this, you know, take Islamic art off the label. movement. And I, in that respect, I'm very much a traditionalist. And, I mean, or let me say, I haven't yet been persuaded that it needs a different label. Although I noticed, Adam, you use the word Islamicate.
Yeah, I
have seen that also being adopted in our field. So I see it being. I think that's going to be maybe the next. But I also wanted to say that while I was working on this, I had you very much in mind because I've been hearing your talks about poetry and the hierarchies of poetry, what's good, what's bad, what's ugly. And it sort of echoed a lot in looking at the kind of trajectory of traditions. Conceptions of what's art, what's good art, what's not art, the idea of eclectic being really bad taste.
So you were involved. I mean, you were involved with the gallery. I mean, you must be in the room when that conversation was happening, right?
Yeah.
So who won? Who did you come to?
I can't really say, because I don't think I was actually in the room when the conversation that mattered was happening.
I felt the Persian donors who insisted that the word is not the time.
Oh, is that what it
is? It's just the builders.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
But I wasn't in the room with them.
Right.
So I can't really say. It was.
So it wasn't a theoretical thing, it was a cracker.
I think what's important, though, in a way, I think what's important in a way is that whether or not it was a theoretical decision, theory-based decision, it was crafted to appear as a theory-based decision. And it was received, and it has been received very much as a theory-based decision. So in some of the reviews of the gallery and some of the state of the field pieces of writing that have come out since then, that has been woven in as if it's a theoretical decision. So some people use it as ammunition to if they're in favor of kind of renaming and ranking. So some people see this as the Met has already gone in this direction.
But they still have the Department of Islamic Arts.
Yeah.
And when you go to the museum, everybody calls it still the Islamic Arts. Yeah. I mean, we have an equally silly situation here. We have a museum of Coptic art, museum of Islamic art. I mean, that also frightens me at times.
That's interesting. I hadn't thought of it that way at all. To me, it seems like a wonderful thing that there's a museum of both either. How amazing. So, how's that for a nice answer?
Thank you,
Diane.
I know
that.
Yeah.